Okay, so this is our great pleasure to have Julien Guyon for our seminar. Julien is at Bloomberg in New York. He's actually in New York at Bloomberg, physically. And he is also teaching at Columbia University and NYU, how it is shown on the slides. He has been educated in France, got his PhD in France. I don't remember the year, but I should remember that.
2006.
Some years ago, yeah. 2006. And is an expert in many things related to smile and stochastic volatility. And he has written great papers and great books, in particular the one with Pierre-Henri Bordet, which I love much, on nonlinear models. And so today we'll talk to us about dispersion constraint Martingale Schrödinger problems and the joint S&P VIX spike calibration puzzle, which is really a puzzle, and Julien is an expert in it. So the screen is yours, Julien.
Thank you very much, Jean-Pierre, for the very kind words and for the invitation to talk at the seminar at UCSB. Of course, I would have preferred to be with you in person, like you kindly invited me a few years ago, and it was a great pleasure to deliver a talk at the seminar and also a mini course. I have really great memories of that very hot, actually, even days, early October 2016. I don't know if you remember, it was really, really hot, unusually hot. And it was a great pleasure to see almost all of you. I think you were maybe here, maybe not remain. Yeah, you are, of course, a great group of financial mathematics in the US. And thanks for the several invitations. So today I want to give a talk indeed on this like longstanding problem in quant finance, which is the joint calibration of the S&P and VIX SMILES. It's a problem that Jean-Pierre has studied with Yuri like a few years ago in a paper where you suggested one method based on Heston with stochastic vol-of-vol. So you know the difficulty of the problem, and it has eluded quants for many years. And I will present the first exact solution to this problem is based on quite a very different approach from what people have tried over the years, which is like a discrete time model and non-parametric model. So I'll explain. And in particular, it comes naturally when you look at the problem in terms of a dispersion constraint Martingale Schrödinger problem. Okay, so that's going to be the main mathematical tool that I will use to build one solution to this problem. So you all know that the volatility indices in general, such as the VIX index, of course, they are used as market implied indicators of volatility, which is the kind of temperature of volatility. But it's much more than this, because you have futures and options on these indices that are liquidly trade on the market and that are widely used to risk manage the volatility exposure of options portfolio. And because VIX futures and VIX derivatives are very liquid, the same way as S&P options are very liquid, the financial institution must price, hedge, and risk manage their S&P and VIX portfolio using models that perfectly fit market prices of both S&P and VIX futures and options jointly. If you want, it's the classical problem of calibrating a stochastic volatility model to liquid hedging instruments. So typically, when you only have the S&P options and you forget about the VIX, then you want your stochastic volatility model to be calibrated to the full surface of implied volatilities, because you will use the vanilla options on the S&P as hedges and in order to decrease the variance of your final hedge P&L. And so now you're just adding extra instruments, which are the VIX futures and VIX options, because you can of course use them, and you should use them to try to reduce the variance of your final PNM of your delta hedge position, hedge position in general. So delta hedge and hedge in vanilla options in the S&P and in the VIX. And so in particular, since VIX options started trading in 2006, many researchers and practitioners, they've tried to build a jointly calibrating model, but they could only at best get approximate fits. Okay, and this problem is very challenging, especially for short maturities, and has been often called the holy grail of volatility modeling. So what I'm going to present today is actually the first solution to this long-standing issue. So actually in three steps. So first, we will characterize the absence of joint S&P VIX arbitrage and actually build an algorithm to detect those arbitrages when they exist. Second, in absence of joint arbitrage, we will build both theoretically and numerically a model that jointly calibrates, okay, to S&P and VIX MI. So the model will be cast as a unique solution of a dispersion constraint Martingale Schrödinger problem. And the problem is numerically solved by duality using an extension of the SINCORN algorithm. So it's alternating projections. And finally, we will show how our construction extends to continuous time stochastic volatility models. Okay, and using basically so what we dub dispersion constraint Martingale Schrödinger bridges. You know, so bridges is to insist on the fact that it's in continuous time and that they are very much inspired by the classical Schrödinger bridge of a statistical mechanics. So I pointed here, but I think I won't have time to cover it. By the way, how much time do I have? You're muted, actually, Jean-Pierre.
You have a total of 1 hour, including questions. So
okay, yeah.
It depends if we have question in the middle or not. So 50 minutes and then question.
Okay. So yes, I think I won't have time to cover this, but I mentioned it in case you want to have a look at the paper and because it's related to this joint calibration issue. So I uncovered the remarkable feature of the S&P and VIX market that I call the inversion of convex ordering. Okay. And explain how classical stochastic volatility models can reproduce it. And in particular, I've proved together with Beatrice Acciaio, that this inversion of convex ordering explains why, contrary to what you often hear on the trading floors, among the continuous stochastic volatility models that are calibrated to the market smile, the local volatility model is actually not the one that maximizes the prices of VIX futures. Okay, also derived like optimal model free bounds on the prices of VIX futures given S&P SMILE. So forgetting about VIX options. Okay, but I actually more focus on this first part of the agenda here on really the joint calibration problem. So just a brief reminder on the VIX. So I'm sure that everybody's on the same page. Okay, so VIX stands for volatility index. It's published every 15 seconds by the CBOE. It's known as the fear factor, and it's supposed to be like an indicator of short-term options implied volatility. So what's the objective of CBOE? CBOE wants to reflect the 30-day implied volatility of S&P options. But of course, the problem is that if you just look at classical call and put on the S&P, then you have a strike attached to each option. And so you would get a strike-dependent measure, right, of implied volatility, and you actually want your measure of volatility to be strike independent, right? Strike free. So a natural choice would be to actually define the VIX as the implied volatility of a 30-day variance swap on the S&P, because the variance swap is strike free. But the problem is that variance swaps are not traded on the exchange, right? They are OTC. And actually, VIX is defined as the implied volatility of a 30-day lock contract on the S&P via this formula here. So if you have a continuous time model without jumps on the S&P, okay, so that would actually correspond to the continuous time version of the 30-day variance swap. Okay, so this is exactly the definition of the VIX. You see, so on the left-hand side is the VIX squared. So you will have to take the square root of this to get the VIX. And it's the price at the current time where you compute the VIX of the lock contract with maturity T plus tau, tau denoting 30 days, okay? And you just have this -2/tau here, which is here precisely so that the VIX is the implied volatility. So that means that if you actually price this thing in the Black-Scholes model, what you would get here is exactly sigma squared, where sigma is the Black-Scholes volatility in your model, right? So that's the definition of the, at least the stylized definition of the VIX. If you look at the contractual definition of the VIX, then you have the trapezoidal replication of the lock contract, but that's the stylized definition that we will use. Of course, the lock contract is not itself listed on the exchange, but you can replicate the lock contract by the classical Karmanen formula using like an infinite sum of out the money call and put options on the S&P with maturity T plus tau. So the VIX index itself cannot be traded. What you can trade are VIX futures, for instance. So the VIX future, of course, expiring at maturity cap T, is just the instrument that will pay you VIX cap T at maturity cap T. So what is interesting is that the VIX squared can be replicated simply using vanilla options on the S&P. Okay, so because remember the definition of the VIX squared that is here. So if you want, if imagine you're at time zero and you say, oh, I want to invest in the S&P today at time zero, so that at a later date cap T, I will be rich of VIX cap T squared. So what should I do? I should simply buy a calendar spread of log contracts on the S&P. You see, so I buy minus two over tau log contract maturing T plus tau on the S&P. I sell the same F cap T. So F is just the forward at time T for, so if you want, this would be just S cap T if there is no interest rate, if there is no cap return. And because if you do that, what is your wealth at cap T? It's exactly the price at cap T of this thing here, right? That's the calendar spread with the minus two over tau contract. But this is by definition of the VIX, that's the VIX square, right? So you know exactly at time zero to replicate the wealth VIX squared at a later date cap T just by trading in the S&P options. But that's not true for the VIX itself, because you have to take the square root, which is not affine, right? So for the VIX itself, okay, so for the price of the VIX future, well, it cannot simply be inferred by arbitrage arguments from the S&P smile. And of course, we have VIX options. Okay, the payoffs are the classical one here, VIX, the positive part of VIX T minus K, okay, minus VIX T. So what is important is that, so actually the underlying asset of VIX options is actually, fine, you can say it's the VIX, but the VIX is not tradable, right? So it's actually the VIX future. Yeah, and you have one maturity per underlying asset, per VIX future, and that's the same maturity as the expiry of the VIX future, right? So if you have a VIX future that expires at cap T, then you have options on these VIX futures, and their maturity is also cap T, the same as the expiry of the VIX future. Because it's important to notice that for different T, actually the underlying is different, right? Because the VIX future maturity T is not the same as the VIX future maturity T prime, even though they might be very correlated, but they are different. They are different objects, right? They are different assets. And the VIX options are, you know, quoted and very, very liquid. And so remember that, yeah, here we had this interesting relationship between the VIX squared and the portfolio of S&P options. We can also get the VIX squared just by summing prices of VIX options, right? And that's again the Karmanin replication formula, but that is now used with the function f being the square, just the parabola, and x being just the VIX future. Right? So that's the thing. So that means that the price of the VIX squared at time zero, you can get it either from the smile of the S&P, okay, to this formula here. So that would be just the price at time zero of this would be the price at time zero of the right hand side, which is just basically the price at time zero of the log contract here. Or you can also get it by summing call out the money calls and put options on the VIX, so from the VIX market. And we'll go back to. And this topic of joint calibration is, of course, an important one, because look at the average daily volumes for VIX options and VIX futures here from 2006 to 2017. You know, it's like more than 600,000 per day for the option, 300,000 per day for the VIX futures. So it's a big, big market. So I mentioned that this joint calibration problem is very challenging, especially for short maturity. So why so? Like, I want to explain at least the main idea. Here is the smile of the S&P maturity, 30 days. It could be another. It's not the 30 days of the VIX, but just a short maturity of the S&P option. So what matters most here is the slope, right? So the fact that you have like a very large negative slope, especially here at the money, for the S&P option. So typically, when you change the strike by 1%, then you decrease the implied volatility by 1.5 points. Okay, so that would correspond to at the money skew. What I call the skew is the slope at the money skew of minus 1.5. Okay, No, that's the VIX smile. So you see it's completely different because it's upward sloping. But actually what matters most here is not really the slope, it's the value. And the value, you can say, you could say it's high, right? Because it's around 100% here for like the first monthly maturity, 28 days at the money. And of course, compared to maybe here, that's around like 10, 15%. So of course the 100% here is much higher. But actually I argue and I claim that this value here, 100%, is actually small. And it's small compared to what? Compared to the slope, not compared to the value here, but compared to the slope of the smile of the S&P, so at the money, a skew of the S&P. So why do I say it's small? Because, okay, so that's just the definition of the at the money skew, which I denote by this S calligraphic T, okay? So that's the minus 1.5 typically for the S&P market for short maturities. Now, if you look at classical one-factor stochastic volatility model, you can think of the Heston model, for instance, but any one-factor stochastic volatility model, well, we know that this at the money skew will have a finite limit when t goes to zero, which is just 1/2 times the spot vol correlation times the vol of vol. And so if you want to recover this minus 1.5 here, because the spot vol correlation cannot go below minus one, right? So you have to use at least 3 for the vol of vol. Okay, but 3 is like 300%, right? So that means that you would actually expect something more like around here, like around 300%. If you want, in a one-factor stochastic volatility model for short maturities, if you want, you know, your at the money skew here of the S&P of minus 1.5 to be consistent with the at the money value of the with the vol of vol, sorry, of the model, and of course the vol of vol of the model is directly governs the value of the at the money implied volatility of the VIX, right? The VIX implied volatility, because the VIX is so short term, is very close to the vol of vol. So to sum up, what happened is that the very large negative skew of short term S&P options, which in classical continuous stochastic volatility model implies a very large volatility, seems actually inconsistent with the comparatively low level of VIX implied volatility. So actually it's not completely true because you have other parameters like the mean reversion that comes into play. If you have a mean reversion, if you mean revert much more than like the 30 days of the VIX, then indeed you can explain the decrease. And that's the whole story about the inversion of convex ordering. But globally, that's the main idea why it's difficult. It's because you basically have one handle, which is the vol of vol, to control two different things. One is the skew of the S&P and the other is the implied vol of the VIX. Okay. And it's hard to, you know, you cannot have one number that satisfies both constraints. So that materializes in many numerical experiments in the past. So here I mentioned experiments by Jim Gatherall in 2008, where he suggests like a double CEV model of this type. Okay, so parametric but quite a rich model. This is the best joint calibration that he gets for. So here that's of course the VIX smile, because you see it's upward sloping. So the model is in orange and the rest is market data. And that's for the S&P smiles. Okay, so you see globally the fit is decent. But when you zoom in, especially for short maturity, you see that actually, especially around the money, you have too much implied volatility for VIX options, maybe 10% too large. And you don't have enough skew. When I say don't have enough, it's in absolute value, right? You don't have enough at the money skew for the S&P. So when you see something like that, you would say, "Ah, okay. So here I see that my vol of vol is too large, so I would like to decrease the vol of vol parameter to decrease the orange line, because if you decrease the vol of vol, that will decrease the at the money vol of the implied the implied volatility of the VIX. But if you do that, then yeah, that will decrease in absolute value the slope of the smile, right, of the S&P, and it's already too small." Again, so you see the conflict here. So I got similar results with different models. So the skewed two-factor Bergoghi model, where basically, so when I say skewed, it's just that it's not a classical two-factor Bergoghi model, but just like instead of using one exponential, we use a linear combination of two exponential in the model so as to generate positive skew on the VIX. Okay, but that's just a variation of the classical two-factor Bergoghi model. So that's the equivalent, the extension to a rough Bergoghi models, the coin like skewed rough Bergomi model. So you see the classical rough Bergomi model would consist of having just one stochastic exponential here. And now you take a linear combination of those two stochastic exponentials with two different parameters, which you can, you know, interpret as ball of balls, like mu naught and mu one here. And that allows to generate positive skew on the VIC. So that's the nice thing about it. And also, like recently, Gavrol, Juslin, and Rosenbaum, they have suggested the quadratic rough Eston model. And in all those, for all those models, if the VIC smile is well calibrated, then you don't have enough Adamone skew on the SNP. Okay, so that's exactly what was suggested. So here are some results for the skewed rough Bergomi. This is just market data, so VIX implied volatilities for the first monthly maturity, second, third, and fourth. So you see here that the model being in blue, the skewed rough Bergomi, I can actually well calibrate the first four maturities, for instance, for the VIX smile. But then even if I use the most negative, so rho is equal to minus one spot vol correlation in the model, then I cannot generate enough Adamone skew for the S&P. Okay, so that's consistent with what I said before. Those are the results by Gavrol, Juslin, and Rosenbaum. So here are very short VIX maturities, VIX smiles. So even so, those ones are the weekly smiles. So that's why you have a larger bid offer. So only this one is a liquid one. So you see, if you're in the bid offer for the VIX options, that you have a decent fit for the S&P smile. But when you zoom in, you see that the model, which is in green, does not produce enough at the Monescu. And even though the smiles are close, actually the slopes are not that close. It's like a 25% difference. So that corresponds to like 25 mispricing of call spreads, for instance, at the Monet call spreads or the Monet digital calls, for instance. And other experiments in the same vein, in this recent paper that I posted like a few months ago. So the VIX future in Bergomi models, analytic expansions and joint calibration with S&P skew. So here I'm looking at the two-factor Bergomi model, so the not skewed, but the classical one. And what I represent here, so it's different, so it's not smiles. Of course, you see it's a maturity in years in the x-axis. So it's a term structure of the S&P at the Adamone skew on the left-hand side and the what I call the VIX squared implied volatility on the right-hand side. So what is the VIX squared implied volatility? That's just the volatility of the VIX squared implied by the price of the VIX future. So if the VIX squared were log normal, you look at the price of the VIX future and you get the VIX squared, of course, the price of the VIX squared at time zero from the market data. And so those are market points in red. And so I'm looking at the classical two-factor Bergomi model and I considered several calibrations. So for the light blue curve, I am calibrating to the term structure of the Adamone skew. Okay, so that's on the left-hand side, you see here, I'm well calibrated to the red dots. But then in that case, I get a VIX1 implied volatility that's too large. Okay, VIX1 implied volatility, if you want, is like a strike-free measure of VIX implied volatility. And on the other hand, if I consider, if I want to calibrate my model to the term structure of the VIX squared implied volatility, so that's the purple curve that you see here. So, but now then I don't have enough skew in absolute value for the S&P. Okay, so that's what we saw before. So again, it showed, and of course, you can try to do as best as you can to fit both at the same time. That's the a dark blue curve, but it doesn't really work. So that also shows that classical stochastic volatility models they are not rich enough to calibrate jointly to S&P and VIX. So I mentioned your paper, Jean-Pierre, with Yuri Saporito that was published in 2018, where you suggested using the Heston model an extension of the Heston model with stochastic volatility of volatility, and especially a vol of vol that would be driven by one a fast mean reverting factor and one slow mean reverting factor, and doing perturbation analysis and perturbation techniques. You explain how you could estimate the price of both the S&P and the VIX option in the market. But unfortunately, this approach does not apply to very short maturities, below 4 months, if I remember correctly. And that's quite unfortunate because precisely the VIX derivatives are most liquid and the calibration is most difficult precisely for those short maturities. There's also paper by Gut, Ismail, and Pham, which suggests like basically regime switching Heston model. But unfortunately, there is a mistake in the numerical experiments. They are not working with the correct market smile, so we can't really draw conclusions from that. And I here quote Jacquet Martini and Muguruza, who say in their paper on the VIX futures in the Rothbergian model, interestingly, we observe a 20% difference between the vol-of-vol parameter obtained through VIX calibration and the one obtained through S&P. This suggests that the vol-of-vol in the S&P market is 20% higher when compared to VIX, revealing potential data inconsistencies, arbitrage question mark. So of course, this does not reveal any arbitrage. Even if you have a large class of stochastic volatility model that is not consistent with the market data, it's just that the class of models is inconsistent with market data. It's just not rich enough to explain market data, but it does not reveal any arbitrage. We will characterize arbitrage. And I'll come back to this when I talk about continuous time at the end of my talk, but there's this recent paper by Guo, Loeper, Obloy, and Wang that suggests using nonlinear semi-martingale optimal transport for this joint calibration problem that's very closely related to the VIX constraint Martingale Schrodinger wedges that I will present at the end. To finish on the long introduction, but I want to really motivate the topic, of course, you could incorporate jumps in the dynamics on the S&P, and many people have done that. I'm citing a few of them here. Indeed, when you add jumps to the S&P dynamics, first, you had degrees of freedom, and those degrees of freedom are the nice property that they partly decouple the Hadamard skew of the S&P and the Hadamard implied vol of the VIX. So that's something that you would like, because that's precisely what's missing in those classical models. But so far, all the attempts have only produced an approximate fit. So okay, here,
cool question.
Sure, of course.
Yeah. So you mentioned that jumps. What about, so in the interest rate literature, as I'm familiar, the homogeneous models don't fit market data well in terms of the calibration problem. When you add time homogeneous, there are different transformations, time changes or shifts and so on. So when you add these time inhomogeneous kind of modifications to the model, you get pretty much perfect fits. Is there any similarity?
Well, you get a perfect fix because I guess you want to calibrate to a zero Poisson curve or something like that. And indeed, so what you see, what the degree of freedom that missing. Yeah. So, but you see, if you want, it's the same as local volatility. For instance, you have this double infinity of implied constraints that are the implied volatilities indexed by strike and maturity, and somehow you want to introduce a double infinity of parameters, which is this local volatility of T and S, so that you're at least in a good position. You have as many parameters as constraints, if you want, and that's this. Here, somehow it's a bit more complicated because we have like, it's not really like a quadruple infinity because we have two. It's not, the thing is that the VIX implied volatilities are not really a surface because you have only a finite number of VIX futures. And so, but if you consider like that it's two surfaces, then there would be like, you would need a four dimensions of parameters and two for the strikes and maturity of the S&P, two for the strike and maturity of the VIX. But it's not clear how it would work, because the thing is that the VIX is basically the volatility of the S&P, right? Mm-hmm. So the two markets are very intricately related, and it's not as simple as having just one asset. Mm-hmm. You see, the thing is that here the two assets, one is really is one asset is basically the implied volatility of the other, so they absolutely cannot be treated as in classical models where you just look at typically just one asset. Even in the interest rate models that you are considering, you just have one asset, and then you try to include new degrees of freedom.
But then how do jumps help? Yeah, maybe let's keep this until the end, because I don't. I know you have a lot of slides, so maybe I don't want to take too much time. But
here the jumps help because they you can generate more at the Monet skew of the S&P without generating more, variance on the S&P.
Yeah, well, I can do that with a time dependent drift somewhere, but maybe I'm not seeing the entire picture well enough. So let's maybe keep that to the end.
Okay. We can go back.
Yep. Thanks.
Later to the question. Okay, so here what I'm presenting is the first exact solution to this S&P VIX calibration problem, and it's a completely different approach. Okay, and it's an approach that's based on dispersion constraint martingale Schrödinger problem. Completely different because instead of postulating a parametric continuous time jump diffusion model on the S&P, I will actually build a non-parametric discrete time model. Okay, so non-parametric allows me to perfectly fit this mind. And discrete time will allow me to decouple S&P skew and VIX impact vol very easily. So what do? I consider a VIX future maturity T1. Okay, so T1 is a VIX future maturity. And we build a joint probability measure on S1, V, and S2. So S1 is the S&P at T1. S2 is the S&P at T2, T2 being T1 plus 30 days. Okay, and V is the VIX at T1. Okay. So this probability measure will be exactly calibrated to the S&P smiles at T1 and T2, and the VIX futures and the VIX smile and the VIX future, sorry, and the VIX smile at T1. And on top of that, the model will satisfy the martingality condition on the S&P. Okay, so it's an arbitrary condition, and the consistency condition that the VIX at T1 is indeed the implied volatility of the 30-day low contract on the S&P. Right, if you want, so the V in my model here has to satisfy the fact that it really represents the VIX, right? So it really the implied volatility of the 30-day log contract on the S&P. And the model is actually cast as a solution of the dispersion constraint. Schrödinger problem, actually, I should say. And is solved using the SYNCHRON algorithm, so in the spirit of a recent paper by Adrien de Marche and Pierre-Henri Labordet. So all the details, the paper has been published last year in RISC, and I will actually post soon like a more mathematical version with new results and all the proofs. So again, this is the picture that you need to have in mind. T1 here, T2 30 days later. At T1, you know the S&P and the VIX, and at T2, you know S2. For simplicity, I will just assume zero interest rate, repos, and dividend, but of course. It's just for simplicity. Mu1, Muv, Mu2 denote the risk-neutral distributions of S1, V, and S2 that you know from the market smile of the S&P and the VIX. So I assume that I have a full, for the continuum of strikes for those maturities. So if you want, I have interpolated, extrapolated. So I have the full risk-neutral distribution. And I will simply denote by, so EI, the expectation under Mu I, and the very mild assumptions that I make is that the log contract and the VIX squared have a finite prices. And we know, of course, that absence of S&P calendar arbitrage means that mu1 is smaller than mu2 in convex order. So if you want the call on the S&P with a given strike, maturity T2 are more expensive than the ones for maturity T1. So that I recall the definition of the VIX. So here, there is the VIX squared is basically the price of this forward starting log contract. I don't want to write -2 over tau all the slides, so I will introduce this L, capital L notation, which is just basically the -2 over tau times the log, so it's negative the log, so you see it's now decreasing and convex. I will still say log, but it's this L function. Okay. And tau denotes 30 days. Okay, so first some reminder introduction on super replication and duality, so for this, for optimal transport problem. So it's well known that the knowledge of just the two marginals mu1 and mu2 gives little information on the prices of options on S1, S2. Okay, so for instance, forward starting options. Precisely computing the upper and lower bound of these prices is the subject of optimal transport introduced by Monge in 1781, you see here. And we use the modern version by Kantorovich proposed in 1942. Okay, and when we're in finance and S is some price of some asset, then we know that S1, S2 is a martingale. And so that leads to more precise bounds, okay, because you're adding a constraint on the fact that the average of S2 over S1 given S1 has to be one, right? So that's the subject of martingale optimal transport, which was introduced by Pierre-Henri Labordère in 2011. I remember I was a colleague of Pierre at the time at SocGen, and I'm here citing the book that he wrote in 2017. And what I'm doing here in this talk is I'm saying, oh, but when S is the S&P, we have more information because we have VIX market data information that's available to us. And so that will produce even more precise bounds because it will give us some information on the conditional dispersion of S2 over S1, which is precisely controlled by the VIX. So we know the average is one, okay? And then we have information on the dispersion of it through the L function. Remember this log function, that's a convex. And so that's what I call dispersion constraint martingale optimal transport, and that's the subject of this talk. So this is an example of a transport plan, right, where you have the correct marginal distribution mu one here, the correct marginal distribution mu two here, and of course you have plenty of them. So let's first look at the super replication problem. So you are interested in the upper bound for the price of a payoff F that actually may depend also on V, like S1, V, S2. And it is what it is, by definition, is the smallest price at time zero of a super replicating portfolio. So we are going to consider super replicating portfolios following the seminal paper by DeMarco and Henri Labordère, and that we continued with Romain Ménégo and Marcel Nutz. So we are, compared to those papers, we are considering not only vanilla options on the S&P, okay, for our super replicating portfolio, but also vanilla options on the VIX. Okay, so that's another key here. So the cost of setting up this portfolio at time zero, but it's just the sum of the market prices of those vanilla options, right? And they can be written as a risk neutral expectation. At time T1, on top of that, we will allow for dynamic hedge, right? So we can delta hedge on the S&P, but we can also hedge in the log contract. That means for any unit of log contract that I buy at time T1, I know that the price of it, by definition of the VIX, will be VIX squared. Okay, so this is exactly the PNL that I will get in the end. Okay, I buy one unit of S2 that costs me S1. I buy one unit of the log contract here that costs me V squared. So in the end, this will be a costless position. And of course, I decide the number of units in my delta, so my delta, if you want, at time T1. And so it may depend on S1 and V because I know S1 and V at T1. Okay. So I will use this shorthand notation just to shorten the equations. So when you see delta with a superscript S here, that means really the delta multiplied by S2 minus S1. Okay. And when you have the delta with superscript L, that's this function delta here, multiplied by, you know, the PNL from just buying one unit of the log contract. That is, okay, so that's just the PNL from delta heading in the spot and in the log contract. So the model independent no arbitrage upper bound for the derivative with price F is simply the smallest price at time zero of a super replicating portfolio. So I consider all the super replicating portfolios. That means that all the defined by the vanilla payoffs U1, UV, U2, and the deltas, okay, that I just defined, described. I consider the portfolios here that are greater than F in all states of the world. And then I look at the one that is the cheapest. Okay, and that's the solution to this problem here. So I will use the shorthand notation with the O plus here, okay, for this function here. Okay, so it's a function of S1 plus a function of V plus a function of S2. And in that case, the super application constraint simply reads like this. Okay. Again, this is not just the delta, right? It's the delta times S2 minus S1, and this is the delta times L minus V squared. And you see that's a linear program because your parameters are U1, UV, and the deltas. The constraints are linear and the objective is linear. So that's a linear program. And each time you have a linear program, of course, you have a dual problem. And here the dual problem is one of maximizing the expectation of the payoff over a set of risk neutral measure P. And what is this set P? That's the set of all probability measures on S1, V, and S2, such that S1, V, and S2 have the prescribed marginal, so the market marginals, and you have the martingality constraint that is here. So you see that's really a martingality condition on the S&P. Okay, so you see that I condition by S1 and V because at time T1, we know S1 and V. And that's the consistency condition. That is actually a condition on the dispersion of S2 over S1 around its average, which is 1. And that's exactly the definition of the VIX here, right? So here it tells you that this quantity V is indeed the VIX, the 13-day implied volatility of the log contract. Okay, so that's the dual problem that here. And you can easily prove following following the lines of the proof of the paper on the similar paper on martingale optimal transport by Matthias Begelbock, Henri Labordère, and Penckner, you get exactly the same result here, absence of a duality gap, right? So that improves. So here, what I'm just adding here is that when you are adding VIX market data information, okay, so you are having bonds that are closer to each other, it can be actually to the point that actually it may reveal a joint S&P VIX arbitrage. That would actually correspond to the situation where the set calligraphic P, so remember that set calligraphic P that's important for the rest of the talk, that's this one here of the measures that satisfy those five conditions, 3 about the marginal distributions and 2 that are like those two conditional expectations. If the set P, question to the set P being empty. And actually it's quite funny that in the limit where the set P is just a singleton, that would tell you that if you add the VIX market data information, that would completely specify the joint distribution of S1, S2, and in particular, for instance, the price of forward starting options. But of course, in practice, there's no reason why that should be the case. Okay, I think I should speed up a bit. So what do I call a joint S&P VIX arbitrage? So remember, UF were all the portfolios that super replicate F. So U0 is just a portfolio that super replicates 0. And I call an arbitrage an element of U0, so a portfolio that super replicates 0, but that has a negative price. Okay. That's a strong definition of an arbitrage. That's equivalent to this inf being minus infinity. Of course, there is a clear arbitrage if this equality here is violated. This equality here is telling you that the price of the VIX squared from the VIX smile is the same as the price of the VIX squared computed from the S&P smile. So you remember the price of the VIX squared, you can get it by using a log calendar spread on the log contract on the S&P, that's this one. Or you can also compute it just by summing out the money calls and puts on the VIX. And this, if this does not hold, then it's very easy you just pick this portfolio that's here, you very easily build an arbitrage. Okay. And so it has been reported in the literature, in the market, we observe that this is not satisfied. But I don't know what it means actually, because both the left-hand side and the right-hand side, they depend on extrapolations of the smile. Smile of the S&P here and smile of the VIX here. Okay, so it's not, I don't know what it means when it's violated. It depends on what are the extrapolations that you are using. So what I do is, as a step zero in all my numerical experiments, I always build consistent extrapolation of the VIX and the S&P smiles so that this equality holds. And they prevent like the trivial arbitrage they prevent. Then you can quite easily show this theorem, like by, let's say, like a smart application of the Strassen theorem. You prove that the fact that the market is free of S&P VIX arbitrage is equivalent to the fact that P is non-empty. That's not surprising for anyone in financial math. And that's also equivalent to the fact that there exists a coupling nu of mu1 and mu v, so the distributions of the two quantities S1 and V that are known at time T1, such that under this coupling nu, the distributions of two random variables in dimension 2, which are those ones, are in convex order. So that's the result here. Okay, so just in the interest of time, I should directly go to the solution to this long-standing puzzle, how to build a model that jointly calibrates to the S&P and the VIX options. Okay, and recall that this set calligraphic P, is this one here. So this means that the smiles are well calibrated, right? this means that the model is actually arbitrage free. And this means that actually V is indeed what it's supposed to be. So the V here is indeed the VIX. Okay, so we are assuming absence of joint arbitrage. Okay, so I'm assuming, so from the theorem that I've just mentioned, that means assuming that this set P is non-empty. And so we know it's non-empty, that's our assumption. And now we want to build a model mu in P. So either there is an arbitrage, okay, but if there's an arbitrage in the market, there's an arbitrage. I'm not going to be able to, you know, build a model that gently calibrates because the model will be arbitrage free. So if there's an arbitrage in the market, there's no. Okay. And so if there's no arbitrage, then the set P is non-empty. Okay, that's good. Now I say, how do I build an element in P? That's the thing. You know that the set P is non-empty, but how do you build an element in P? And so our strategy will be very much inspired by, so I mentioned the recent paper by Demarche and Henri Labordère, but actually also 20 years ago by the seminal papers by Marco Avellaneda that used like a minimum entropy for calibration. So we are going to use a reference probability measure, mu bar. Okay, that's our reference. And we are going to look for the measure mu in the set P that minimizes the relative entropy with respect to mu bar. Okay, with respect to mu bar. That's also known as the Kullback Leibler divergence. Okay, so the definition is here again. So basically, that's the expectation of the log density, right, with respect to the reference measure. Okay, if you are absolutely continuous with the reference measure and plus infinity otherwise. So basically you are looking at the measures that are absolutely continuous with respect to your reference measure, and you look at the expected log density. And actually this is a strictly convex problem because of the strict convexity of the relative entropy. And that can be solved after dualization using a synchronous fixed point algorithm or iteration. Okay, and that's how we will build our model. So this is, you know, just to illustrate what we are doing. We have a set P, you know, it's not empty. We take some mu bar, it's just a reference measure, and we minimize the distance of P to mu bar, and the projection is in P, and that's going to be the model that we build. Okay, so maybe just a very quick reminder on Lagrange multipliers to explain the method. Even though the proof is not made using Lagrange multipliers, but here that's in order to give the intuition. You all know that if you want to minimize f of xy for xy two scalars under the constraint that g of xy is equal to c, well, you introduce a Lagrange multiplier lambda like this. This is the Lagrangian function. You invert sup and inf. Okay, in finite dimensions well known, and then you see that it's easy now to compute the inner infimum because there is no constraint anymore. It's unconstrained. And then you maximize the over lambda, and it's also unconstrained, so it's easy. Okay, and it will be useful for in two or three slides. Remember that the constraint, which is here g of xy is equal to c, you can actually recover it by just saying that, oh, I differentiate the Lagrangian with respect to lambda and I cancel this gradient, right? And that's how I recover the constraint. So here in our case, of course, it's not, we don't have just scalars x and y, so it's more complicated, but the constraint that S1 must have marginal distribution, so S1 must have distribution mu1, it means that for all u1, okay, the expectation under mu1 of u1 of S1 must be equal to the expectation under mu of u1 of S1, okay? So u1 is any payoff, the test function, if you want. Okay, and so that's why you see this inequality, this equality holds here. Like u1 is actually a Lagrange multiplier for this constraint, which is distribution of the constraint. Same for mu2, mu v, and for the martingality constraints, the natural Lagrange multiplier is a function of S1 and V, because the fact that you have this equality here, so the expectation of S2 given S1 and V is S1, is equivalent to the fact that for any function delta, the expectation of delta times S2 minus S1 is equal to zero. Right? That's the definition for the conditional expectation. Okay, and so that's why you have this equality that holds as well. And same thing for the consistency condition that is here. So now what we are going to do is we say, okay, we start from this minimization problem, but that's complicated because you minimize with the five constraints of the set P. Okay, so I introduce Lagrange multipliers to get rid of the constraints. Okay, so I have one constraint for the marginal distribution, number one. for the second marginal distribution, for the third marginal distribution. This one is for the martingality constraints, okay? Because remember delta SS that is here is just the delta times S2 minus S1. And this is the margin, the constraint on the consistency condition. Okay, and so we have this equality. And then that's where you have to do the math, and it's not through the Lagrange multiplier, so we'll explain briefly. If you show that you can, you know, invert, swap the sup and the inf, you get this. And then what is remarkable is that the inner infimum can be exactly computed. Right, you have this infimum over mu unconstrained, because mu now is any measure, probability measure, of relative entropy minus the expectation under mu of some random variable x, which is the red random variable here. And you can compute it exactly. That's, you know, the negative of the log of the expectation under the reference measure of exponential of x. Okay? And on top of that, you know that the infimum is attained exactly at one probability measure, which is of Gibbs type, okay? So that's the one whose Radon-Nikodym derivative with respect to nu bar, the reference measure, is basically exponential x renormalized. Okay, and that's why we liked, and so we chose the reference, the minimum entropy as the distance because of those nice mathematical properties. Okay, and you see that we started from this complicated infimum problem, and now we have a maximization problem of this function. So you see the function now is sup of, well, we have the three terms that are here that were constant independent of mu, and then we have minus log of the this term here, right? And so when I write it here, it's this full term that is here. And most importantly, so and now the sup is unconstrained, right? You take the sup over all vanilla payoffs u1, uv, u2, and all the deltas that are just unconstrained. And so that's easy. You simply cancel the gradient of this function. And most importantly for us, we know that the infimum is attained at mu star defined by its Radon-Nikodym derivative with respect to mu bar, and which is explicitly known as this one. Okay, so if you know the u star that maximizes the J function here, then you've solved your problem and you've built a mu star that's a solution to your joint calibration problem. So actually, I will state the theorem now. The theorem that I said is a little bit more general. So here, I just remind you what we just had with this function J. That I know if you noticed that there was a J log. Why do I say log here? It's because okay, we have a log here. That was the solution. Actually, you can consider like I generalize to any function G that is greater than the log and have the correct value at one, which is zero, okay? So actually you have like also the function J, G here. So instead of taking just the log, you take the G, a function of this expectation. And actually this blue expectation, I call it Z mu bar because you see it's the normalization factor you see here in the density. And E, okay, EX is just when, okay, so let me briefly tell you. So I will consider payoffs that are L1 and deltas that are bounded, or payoffs that are continuous and integrable, and deltas that are continuous and bounded, or everything continuous and bounded. That's what this means. And actually, you can prove, so that's probably the main result in the paper that I will post like in a few days, hopefully. It's almost done. So that you indeed have this strong duality results, so absence of duality gap for any function G, not just for the log contract. Not just for the log. okay, you can even require the payoffs to be continuous and integrable and the deltas to be continuous and bounded. You can even require everything to be continuous and bounded if some extra condition is satisfied here. Moreover, if the set P is non-empty, then we know that this infimum here is attained. And if the problem is finite, okay, so if the solution to this is not plus infinity, then of course P is not empty, okay, because if this is finite, so that means that P is not empty. And then the infimum is uniquely attained. This is easy because it's uniquely attained because of the strict convexity of the relative entropy H. And then we denote mu star the arc mean, okay, the minimum entropy jointly calibrating model. And then the question is, how do you compute this mu star? Well, then, if that what's interesting here is that we have the those equivalencies here. So if you have here a maximizer of the function JLN, so our dual function, then the problem is finite, okay? And you know that this unique jointly calibrating minimum entropy model is of this form here, okay? Actually, if you modify just this U star by a constant, which is the explicit constant that is here, then actually you can build another solution so that actually the renormalization factor, normalizing factor is equal to one. Okay. And the second, and so actually, so those assertions are actually equivalent. And if you work with another function g, which is often used in the literature, which is just g of x is x minus one. So you see it's above the log, and it's basically just a tangent of the log function at point one. If you have a maximizer for this function, for j of this function g, which is just g of x is equal to x minus one, then actually this one is also maximizing any function j g, including the one for the log. And the problem is finite, and you have this explicit expression for the minimum entropy jointly calibrating model mu star. Okay. So what is really important here, and here you don't even have to renormalize, because in that case, the one that maximizes here. So two things that are important here is that first, it's not clear whether there exists a maximizer, okay, for this dual problem. Okay, that's unclear. So it's actually what I call the primal problem, because it's the physical problem, it's the financial problem. So let me call it the primal problem. Okay, it's not clear whether there exist maximizers. Okay, of course you have a sequence of maximizing sequence, but not necessarily a maximizer. If you have a maximizer, then you see that you have this form here for the mu star, and this form is very particular, because you see it's a function of S1 multiplied by a function of V, because it's expansion, multiplied by a function of S2, and then multiplied by this exponential of delta S. Okay, so that's a very, very specific form. And because you have a very specific form, we will be able to derive the Schrödinger equations and explicitly build the U1, UV, U2. So you see here, that's just a repetition of what I said in the theorem. So if you have those maximizers that are U star or U DAG here, we call it Schrödinger potentials, okay, if they exist. Of course, they are not unique, because okay, I don't have time, but you can, if you have some log of S2 here, you can put it in the log here. But there are no uniqueness. And well, there are other issues, but I don't want to enter into details. What is essentially unique is the portfolio, what I call the Schrödinger portfolios, which are basically the sum of all, like the thing in the exponential. Okay. And they basically, by uniqueness of the mu star, basically they are the same up to a constant. And the blue one, I call it the standard Schrödinger portfolio. Maybe I give you a rapid sketch of the proof. Of course, not the proof at all, but so the sketch of the proof work as follows. You would actually, just for the strong duality result, but that's the most important one. You would start by proving a strong duality result for a classical Schrödinger problem, or that's something that you already have in the literature, but in many different forms. So I actually redid it and gave like a new, actually I think simpler proof for this. And this is using the Fenchel. So what I do is using the Fenchel-Rockefeller convex duality theorem, where this function JS, so S is just for Schrödinger, classical Schrödinger problem, SG is this one here, where basically you see it's the same as before, but you don't have the delta terms. Okay, and what is it? So what do I call the classical Schrödinger problem? Is when you only have the marginal constraints. Okay, so I forget about the martingality constraint, and I forget about the fact that v squared is equal to the expectation, conditional expectation of blah blah blah. It's just the three marginal constraints, and then I have this strong duality result. Here you have to be careful, because X, so that's the state space being not compact, is where S1, V, and S2 live. It's not compact. Then the dual of the functions that are bounded and continuous on X is actually quite nasty, and it's strictly larger than the Borel measure or the Radon measures in general, but here the Borel measures on the finite sign Borel measures on X. So you have to be a little bit careful here, but it works. And then you extend to what I call the mixed Schrödinger-Monge-Kantorowicz problem. Basically, you see, instead of just only minimizing H, you minimize H minus some transportation cost. Okay, and here, what you get is also like this strong duality result, where you see in the function J, SMK is for strong, for Schrödinger-Monge-Kantorowicz, F, you have an F. That's here, okay. So you can quite easily prove that, and then finally you go back to the dispersion constraint Martingale-Schrödinger problem by dualizing the martingality and dispersion constraints. That's what we are very interested in. We say, oh, we forget about we only keep the marginal constraints conditions here, and we dualize the martingality and dispersion constraint like this. Okay, so that's what we've seen before. And now we use the weak compactness of pi. So pi is only when we have the marginal constraints, and Sion's minimax theorem to actually swap the inf and the sup. So now the sup goes here, the inf goes here. And now we use this result here, okay, with f being delta s plus delta l to actually get the final result. Okay, so that's how the proof works. Okay, I need to speed up and show you like numerical results now. Yeah,
we can have a chance to ask a few questions.
Yeah. Okay. So basically, now what is really nice is that you have this form. Okay, if you assume that there exist Schrödinger potentials. So how do you compute those U1 star, UV star, UV star, delta star, delta star? Okay. Well, basically, you just cancel the gradient of J, or equivalently, you just write that new star that you know has this particular form has to satisfy the five conditions in the set P. So the first line can be seen as either you differentiate J with respect to the pair of U1 S1, or it can be seen also as you require that the mu star satisfies the first marginal condition given by Merkel. And same for the second line, third line, and this is the martingality condition, and this is the delta condition. So, of course, I don't give you the functions phi1, phi1, phi2, phi2, but what is important is that you see that if I know everything except U1, then that gives me U1. If I know everything except UV, that gives me UV. And same for U2. Okay. And then for the deltas, you have to, you know, basically compute the zeros of those functions. Okay. So you know that the mu star has this particular form. You express the fact that, oh, the mu star, we know that it is in the set P, so it satisfies the five constraints, and that gives you those five equations. And that's quite funny, because from an engineering point of view, I could simply have, that would have been a much shorter talk. I could have just said, okay, let me postulate a model of this form. Oh, and I say that it has to satisfy, you know, all the constraints on the smile, for the smile of the SMP, the smile of the VIX, the martingality, and all that. I would get those equations here, and then I say, oh, let me find a solution to this system, and done. Okay, but then you would not really understand why this form, and, you know, and when it fails, why does it fail, and so on. Okay, so this system of equations is actually the Schrödinger equation, or it's also known as the Schrödinger system. And the way we solve it is just by using the syncorn algorithm that's typically alternating projections. So here in our case, it's really like a fixed point method that alternates maximization in the different directions, one per Lagrange multiplier, to approximate the maximizer, actually, you dagger in our case. So you start from a guess, U0, and then you see when you're at step n, you define the U1, UV, U2, and deltas at step n plus one like this. So you define the U1, n plus one like this. Now you plug it here. Now you know everything except U1 up, that defines a new UV. Then you UV, you put it here, that defines the new U2. Then you put the new U2 here, and that defines the delta S here. You put the new delta S here, that defines the new delta L, and so on and so forth. Okay. And so what is really nice is that each of those lines corresponds to a Bregman projection. So that means that when you do here, when you are at this step here, the model that you are building is exactly calibrated to the Merkel smile of S1, but not to the Merkel smile of V, S2, and does not satisfy the martingality condition. Now, when you are at the next line here, you are exactly calibrated to the smile of the VIX, but not to the smile of S1, okay, not to the smile of S2, and so on. And here, exactly calibrated to the smile of S2, but not to the smile of V. But of course, when you converge, well, you hope to end up with a solution that actually satisfies all the constraints at once, and that's indeed what happens numerically. So, and if the algorithm diverges, then okay, let's say that's a strong sign that there exists a joint S&P arbitrage, but that depends on the support of mu, because it might be that also it might mean simply that there is no model in P that has a finite entropy with respect to mu bar. So the choice of mu bar matters a lot. So here for mu bar in the numerical experiment, I just simply assume that S1 and V are independent, which is stupid, but no, it's not realistic, but it doesn't matter in the numerical experiment. And then conditional on S1V, I assume that S2 is log normal with mean S1 and variance V. And I just do this synchron algorithm, and after like around 100 iterations, this is what I get: smile of S1, smile of S2, and smile of the VIX. You see that I don't have this issue of being well calibrated to the VIX and not enough at the Monescu for the S&P. What is really important is that I need to satisfy the martingality condition and the consistency condition of the VIX. So here you see it's the price of S2 minus S1 divided by S1 for plenty of values of S1 and V. And it's really zero. Like see here, it's 10 to the minus 15. Okay, so that's really numerical zero. So that means the model is, the S is exactly a martingale, okay, in the model here. And this is the same for L of S2 over S1 minus V squared divided by V squared. So this proves that V is really the 30-day implied volatility of the log contract. So V is really the VIX in the model, because again, it's 10 to the minus 13. Okay. That's the joint distribution of S1 and V. Okay, and of course, because I have the joint distribution, I can easily define a local VIX by this formula here. Okay, the expectation VIX squared given S1. And that's the classical shape that we have for local volatilities, if you want. So the model is very actually normal, it's not pathologic at all. It's not weird. These are the conditional distribution of S2 given S1 and V for different values of S1 and V, and the distribution of the normalized return R that you see here, that would be exactly Gaussian in a Black-Scholes model, but that you see has a fat tail to the left as kind of expected. And that's the optimal U1, UV, U2, and delta S and delta L that you get for this model based on this mu bar. That the similar result for the following maturity, which is 49 days, and that's the same result, so I can go very fast. And those are numerical experiments for large VIX, okay, where the VIX was, I think, around 35 or 40% just the day before Christmas 2018, and it works very well as well in those cases.